in this
area. Why are you trying to hide your name and badge number?
I am not.
But you answer to me.
I do not.
Stop breaking the law. Stop breaking the law. Watch out, that's a lawbreaker right here. You like to break the law, be careful.
No, I don't answer to you.
Okay,
I'm free. You're dismissed.
I am not dismissed.
Yes, you are.
Who the fuck is at my window?
I gave you my phone number and I can talk
Why?
To him.
Why? Are you want to ask me on a date? What?
Who the fuck are you? Shining your lights in my window.
Hey, you need to leave.
I don't have to.
You're dismissed.
I'm not dismissed.
You are.
Actually, I think I'll do a foot patrol on this area.
Go ahead. Don't step on my property. You will be trespassing. Live here.
Lower your voice.
You need to leave my property. You are trespassing. You are trespassing. You're going to be going to jail. Follow the law. And what's your name and badge number? Why are you harassing me? Oh, you didn't? Were you fucking blind the 5 times you drove by? Which one of you honked at me? Leave my property now.
The fucking yard
this is private property. You are trespassing.
We're
leave now.
You do not walk on this fucking
What's
property.
Your name?
Sir, that is an assault. I'm trying to get out of these young men's way because you guys are blocking the walkway for anybody to exit, which that's
walkway.
Illegal as well.
You're
I'm not. I'm trying to leave.
Back up to
I would like to leave. I was asked.
Recording.
I was asked, which I can respectfully decline.
Because you were recording.
I was asked. And I can respectfully decline. I'm not here for court, sir. I did not come here for court.
Were you in the courtroom?
It doesn't matter if I was in the courtroom.
Yeah. And you had the camcorder. She wants to talk to
I
you.
I have a camcorder.
So
yeah, I was
option.
Allowed. They let me walk in here very easily with a camcorder. There's never been an issue with me coming in here with a camcorder. Does it say, or is there a sign that says that there are no camcorders allowed in here? Because they didn't stop me. I put it in the bucket and they told me to walk on through.
Yeah, you can have it in the courtroom. You can't.
So then what's the problem? I didn't record. I'm recording right now in the courthouse.
Okay, here is the Bartholomew County local court rules, and what that officer and judge was referring to was this rule, LR03-AR00-1, use of mobile phones and other electronic devices. Here's what it says. Attorneys, the parties in cases before the Bartholomew County courts and the public may bring their mobile phones and other electronic devices into the Bartholomew County courthouse. Attorneys, the parties in cases before the Bartholomew County courts and the public may also take their mobile phones and other electronic devices in the various Bartholomew County courtrooms. All mobile phones and other electronic devices must either be turned off or set to silent mode if taken into any Bartholomew County courtroom. Attorneys, the parties before any Bartholomew County court and the public shall not use their mobile phone or other electronic devices to make, send, answer, or respond to phone calls, text messages, and email messages, or take photos if they are in a Bartholomew County courtroom while that court is in session. Attorneys, the parties before any Bartholomew County court and the public shall not use their mobile phone or other electronic devices to check social media sites, post pictures, notices, updates, and other comments on social media sites, play games, watch videos, listen to music, surf the internet, or conduct any type of internet search if they are in a Bartholomew County courtroom while that court is in session. Pursuant to Rule 2.17 of the Indiana Code of Judicial Conduct and Indiana Supreme Court Administrative Rule 9D4, attorneys, parties before any Bartholomew County court and the public shall not use their mobile phone or any other device to make any type of video or audio recording of the proceeding before the court, the parties and the witnesses in that proceeding, the courtroom, the court staff, and the judge, magistrate, or commissioner of that court. Attorneys, parties before any Bartholomew County court, and the public may not use their mobile phone or any type of camera to take pictures or video of the proceeding before the court, the parties and witnesses in the proceeding, the courtroom, the court staff, or the judge, magistrate, or commissioner of that court. That is what these guys are upholding. They're upholding a rule, a court rule, over our right, our constitutional right to freedom of the press. So these public officials are upholding the Bartholomew County rules of court over the constitutions governing the Indiana Republic. And how pathetic is that? This is what it's come to. And that is not how it's supposed to be, nor is that how it's going to be. The defenders of rights won't stand for it.
In case I needed it for instances like this. Yes, because right now I'm allowed to. You guys are public servants. That's my right, and I have the right to audit and record my public servants to make sure that you guys are doing your jobs correctly. And to force me into doing anything, the law has to give you that right. You have requirements you have to meet. You have to prove that I was using my recording in there.
Yes.
You have to have probable cause. You can't just assume. You have to have probable cause. And where is the law that says that I can't record in there anyways? Because that's a public room. Those are public courtrooms for the public.
So, ma'am, I'm going to ask for one last time.
And I'm respectfully declining.
Answer me first.
I'm respectfully declining, sir.
The judge's order for you to come back up there. Are you refusing to go back up there? Because if you do, you're being held in contempt.
What do I need to go up there for?
Let me finish. You're being held in contempt of court.
For what?
So are you refusing
for what, sir? For what, sir? I have to be knowledgeable of what is going on. What am I being accused of?
She can tell you that, but if you're not going to want to go,
what am I being accused of? Okay, if she wants to come down here and speak with me, if she wants to come down here and speak with me, that's perfectly fine.
She's not going
to
do it.
She is more than welcome to come down here and speak with me. If there's a question or anything that she needs. But right now, as I see it, I'm being unlawfully held here against my will. This is kidnapping.
Kidnapping means we have to actually take you somewhere.
It means that by law, you have no right for what? What crime? What crime?
Open and the face cover off.
No, I asked you what your name and badge number was.
Did you have the camera in your hand and the lid was open?
It's dead, sir. It's dead.
It's dead.
Look, it's dead. It won't even turn on, sir.
It's turning on right now.
Okay, well, look.
You need to
look.
You need to go
exchange battery. Okay. It's dead, sir.
You need to explain that to her.
You just witnessed it. Why don't you explain that to her?
Because that's not my job.
I'm not the officer of the law, but it's not your job.
I'm not the one with an open camera in the courtroom.
But you gave her the information that I had an open recorder in the courtroom.
What'd she say?
But you can't give her the information that it's dead. Mm-hmm. That you are witnessing that it's dead. You can't give her the information that you're witnessing that's dead.
That
so you're going to withhold information from her.
You can do that yourself.
You're going to withhold information from the judge. Why am I being detained? Can anybody tell me why I'm being detained? What law is giving you the right to detain me? Can anybody tell me that? Are you the one detaining me, sir? No? So I'm not detained? Am I free to go?
No.
So why are you detaining me?
You need to go talk to the judge.
So what do I need to talk to the judge about? Is that a law? Is that a law? The law says you need to talk to the judge. What law is giving you the right to detain me? I can't ask her. You're not letting me leave.
You can go that way and I'd be happy to walk you right up to
her. I don't need an escort.
Okay.
So why are you keeping me here? Why are you detaining me against my will? You know that's unlawful, correct?
Okay.
You know that I am filing a lawsuit. There's already lawsuits and this is just getting added to it. You know that, right? I'm sure you've heard about me. Sir, can anybody please tell me why I'm being detained here? No officer has been able to tell me why I'm being detained. Can anybody please tell me why I'm being detained? I need name and badge numbers of everybody here. I know you've been pretty, you haven't seemed to go out of character or anything. Can I have your name and badge number, please? There's a reflection. I cannot read that. Your policy says that you have to tell me your name and badge number. Everybody needs to tell me their name and badge number now, please. That is policy. I am the public. I just want to know why I'm being detained, why I'm being forced to stay here against my will. Can anybody tell me that? This is the Columbus Police Department, or this is the Sheriff's Department. They're over the courthouse here. Yep, these are all, usually the sheriff guys are usually pretty good. Usually it's just CPD that are cause issues, but I guess today they wanted to be tyrannical as well. Can anybody tell me why I'm being detained? Sir, can you tell me why I'm being detained, please?
Because the judge said to.
Okay, it's because the judge said to. Is there a law that gives you the right to detain me?
The judge has the right to detain anybody, yes.
Oh, but without any law or reason? Because as I've been aware that you guys operate under law, correct? You guys operate under law, correct?
Yes.
You guys enforce law, not will? Do you guys enforce law or do we enforce will? Do we enforce law around here or do we enforce will?
The judge has authorized us to either walk up there or we will be forced to carry you up there, okay?
Okay, so under threat, duress, and coercion, I will walk on my own free will up to talk to the judge. Under threat, duress, and coercion, that means all of you that are here and allowing this to occur, that means that when I file my lawsuit, you guys will all be held accountable unless the law gives you permission, because you guys all have requirements to meet before you detain, before you do anything or force any force upon anyone. And I believe it was this man right here who already put his hands on me, which is an assault. He's already seen that my camera is actually dead. He was the one that actually told the judge that I was recording, and which that would be a false report because he did not see anything being recorded.
Can you turn the phone off?
She's recording now, Judge.
I'm sorry. I don't understand why I'm being detained, ma'am. That's fine. I showed this man right here that my camera was actually dead, so he knows that my camera's dead and it was not on. I told him that multiple times, but he wanted to use force. He put his hands on me as well.
I was asking that you back up because it's a violation of the local rules for you to have a camera, and you're doing it right now. It's a violation.
Right, because I have the right to audit and record my public servants, and since they're they're actually detaining me unlawfully, I felt that for my safety, I probably should record. Yeah.
Working on my orders to bring you back up based upon violation.
Right. Is this a public room, ma'am? Is this open to the public? Because as my understanding, I would be allowed to record. You can. I don't even want to be here, ma'am. I don't even want to be here. I can't calm down. I just had hands put on me.
I just had to drop back up here because it's a violation to have a video or audio recording.
Okay.
I simply wanted to ask you about that and let you know the local rule.
Okay.
I have the right to do that because it is a violation of our local rules to do that. And I didn't see that video camera until you left.
Is there a law or something that I can look into that to make sure that there is not allowed to be any recording? Because per Constitution, the Constitution we are in.
I wanted to just ask you.
Right.
If you had it, if it had it.
Well, ma'am, did you take an oath to the Constitution? That's okay. I appreciate it. But I would like it if we could uphold the Constitution and allow freedom of press in our courtrooms. I appreciate it. Thank you. Thank you for putting your hands on me. We won't be needing the gloves, sir. You can take the gloves off. We don't need the gloves. Nobody needs to put their hands on me. And I do not need escorted.
You're being escorted out of the courthouse, ma'am. You can walk out.
She said I was free to go.
You're free to
that
leave
means
the,
I'm not detained.
You're free to leave the courthouse.
I am leaving the courthouse, but I don't want anyone.
Do it in an orderly fashion.
Okay, well, I don't feel comfortable with everybody standing behind me. I don't know what you guys are capable of doing. Well, I'll stand behind you, I guess.
No, you'll go in front of us.
No, I will not. I'm not walking with my back to you guys. You guys have.
We want to express to you how tyrannical these public officials are acting here in Bartholomew County, located in Columbus, Indiana Republic. We have two United States Supreme Court cases, all derived from the document titled The Constitutionally Protected and Secured Right to Locomotion and Personal Liberty, the Right to Travel, and a Private Conveyance / Automobile, written and prepared by one of the members of the Defenders of Rights, Jonathan of the House Abbott. Let's get to the first court case. The first one is Richmond Newspapers Incorporation versus Virginia, United States Supreme Court in 1980. This goes in depth of our First Amendment rights. Quote, of course, trials must be public, and the public have a deep interest in trials. A trial is a public event. What transpires in the courtroom is public property. One of the demands of a democratic society is that the public should know what goes on in courts by being told by the press what happens there, to the end that the public may judge whether our system of criminal justice is fair and right. It is true that the public has the right to be informed as to what occurs in its courts. Reporters of all media, including television, are always present if they wish to be and are plainly free to report whatever occurs in open court. There it is. The principle that justice cannot survive behind walls of silence has long been reflected in the Anglo-American distrust for secret trials. While the right to a public trial is explicitly guaranteed by the Sixth Amendment only for criminal prosecutions, that provision is a reflection of the notion deeply rooted in the common law that justice must satisfy the appearance of justice. Due process demands appropriate regard for the requirements of a public proceeding in cases of criminal contempt, as it does for all adjudications through the exercise of the judicial power, bearing narrowly limited categories of exceptions. And it goes further. The First Amendment, in conjunction with the 14th, prohibits governments from abridging the freedom of speech or of the press, or of the right of the people peaceably to assemble and to petition the government for redress of grievances. These expressly guaranteed freedoms share a common core purpose of assuring freedom of communication on matters relating to the functioning of government. Plainly, it would be difficult to single out any aspect of government of higher concern and importance to the people than the manner in which criminal trials are conducted. As we have shown, recognition of this pervades the centuries-old history of open trials and the opinions of this court. The Bill of Rights was enacted against the backdrop of the long history of trials being presumptively open. Public access to trials was then regarded as an important aspect of the process itself. The conduct of trials, before as many of the people as just to attend, was regarded as one of the inestimable advantages of a free English constitution of government. In guaranteeing freedoms, such as those of speech and press, the First Amendment can be read as protecting the right of everyone to attend trials so as to give meaning to those explicit guarantees. The First Amendment goes beyond protection of the press and the self-expression of individuals to prohibit government from limiting the stock of information from which members of the public may draw. Free speech carries with it some freedom to listen. In a variety of contexts, this court has referred to a First Amendment right to receive information and ideas. What this means in the context of trials is that the First Amendment guarantees of speech and press, standing alone, prohibit government from similarly closing courtroom doors which had long been open to the public at the time the amendment was adopted. For the First Amendment does not speak equivocally. It must be taken as a command of the broadest scope. That explicit language, read in the context of a liberty-loving society, will allow. Good Lord, heavens forbid. The explicit guaranteed rights to speak and to publish concerning what takes place at a trial would lose much meaning if access to observe the trial could, as it was here, be foreclosed arbitrarily. They cannot shut these doors. They cannot prevent the public from entering, watching, observing, taking notes, recording, whatever means it means to document what happens in that courtroom. We have the right. We have the constitutional right to go in a public trial and record. And that's what ultimately Judge Kelly Benjamin has done, has violated the First Amendment right. That is a no-no. That is treason. Let's go further. The Constitution guarantees more than simply freedom from those abuses which led to the framers to single out particular rights. The very purpose of the First Amendment is to guarantee all facets of each right described. Its draftsmen sought both to protect the rights of Englishmen and to enlarge their scope. There are no contrary implications in any part of the history of the period in which the First Amendment was framed and adopted. No purpose in ratifying the Bill of Rights was clearer than that of securing for the people of the United States much greater freedom of religion, expression, assembly, and petition than the people of Great Britain had ever enjoyed. Madison's comments in Congress also revealed the perceived need for some sort of constitutional saving clause, which, among other things, would serve to foreclose application to the Bill of Rights of the maximum that the affirmation of particular rights implies a negation of those not expressly defined. Madison's efforts, culminating in the Ninth Amendment, served to allay the fears of those who were concerned that expressing certain guarantees could be read as excluding others. But arguments such as the state makes have not precluded recognition of important rights not enumerated. Notwithstanding the appropriate caution against reading into the Constitution rights not explicitly defined, the court has acknowledged that certain unarticulated rights are implicit in enumerated guarantees. For example, the rights of association and of privacy, the right to be presumed innocent, and the right to be judged by a standard of proof beyond a reasonable doubt in a criminal trial, as well as the right to travel, appear nowhere in the Constitution or Bill of Rights. Yet these important but unarticulated rights have nonetheless been found to share constitutional protection in common with explicit guarantees. The concerns expressed by Madison and others have thus been resolved. Fundamental rights, even though not expressly guaranteed, have been recognized by the courts as indispensable to the enjoyment of rights explicitly defined. We hold that the right to attend criminal trials, whether the public has a right to attend trials of civil cases, is a question not raised by this case, but we note that historically both civil and criminal trials have been presumably open, is implicit in the guarantees of the First Amendment. Without the freedom to attend such trials, which people have exercised for centuries, important aspects of freedom of speech and of the press could be eviscerated. I agree that the First Amendment protects the public and the press from abridgment of their rights of access to information about the operation of their government, including the judicial branch, given the total absence of any record justification for the closure order entered in this case. That order violated the First Amendment. This nation's accepted practice of guaranteeing a public trial to an accused has its roots in our English common law heritage. This has been going on for centuries, as you heard. And now, with common technology, we are able to record on our cameras what occurs in our courtrooms, in our courtrooms. And we will do so. The defenders of rights will definitely do so. Let's go to the next court case, shall we? The next court case is New York Times Company versus United States, which is the United States Supreme Court in 1971. When the Constitution was adopted, many people strongly opposed it because the document contained no Bill of Rights to safeguard certain basic freedoms. They especially feared that the new powers granted to a central government might be interpreted to permit the government to curtail freedoms of religion, press, assembly, and speech. In response to an overwhelming public clamor, James Madison offered a series of amendments to satisfy citizens that these great liberties would remain safe and beyond the power of government to abridge. Madison proposed what later became the First Amendment in three parts, two of which are set out below, and one of which proclaimed, "The people shall not be deprived or abridged of their right to speak, to write, or to publish their sentiments, and the freedom of the press, as one of the great bulwarks of liberty, shall be inviolable." The Bill of Rights changed the original Constitution into a new charter, under which no branch of government could abridge the people's freedom of press, speech, religion, and assembly. Yet, the Solicitor General argues, and some members of the court appear to agree, that the general powers of the government adopted in the original Constitution should be interpreted to limit and restrict the specific and emphatic guarantees of the Bill of Rights adopted later. I can imagine no greater perversion of history. Madison and the other framers of the First Amendment, able men that they were, wrote in language they earnestly believed could never be misunderstood. The press was to serve the governed, not the governors. The government's power to censor the press was abolished so that the press would remain forever free to censor the government. The press was protected so that it could bear the secrets of government and inform the people. Only a free and unrestrained press can effectively expose deception in government. And paramount among the responsibilities of a free press is the duty to prevent any part of the government from deceiving the people and sending them off to distant lands to die of foreign fevers and foreign shot and shell. In other words, we are asked to hold that despite the First Amendment's emphatic command, the executive branch, the Congress, and the judiciary can make laws enjoining publication of current news and abridging freedom of the press in the name of national security. The government doesn't even attempt to rely on any act of Congress. Instead, it makes the bold and dangerous, far-reaching contention that the court should take it upon themselves to make a law abridging freedom of the press in the name of equity, presidential power, and national security. Even when the representatives of the people in Congress have adhered to the command of the First Amendment and refused to make such a law. The guarding of military and diplomatic secrets at the expense of informed representative government provides no real security for our republic. The framers of the First Amendment, fully aware of both the need to defend a new nation and the abuses of the English and colonial governments, sought to give this new society strength and security by providing that freedom of speech, press, religion, and assembly should not be abridged. Amen. Let's go further. Meanwhile, the administration of government has become more complex. The opportunities for malfeasance and corruption have multiplied. Crime has grown to most serious proportions, and the danger of its protection by unfaithful officials and of the impairment of the fundamental security of life and property by criminal alliances and official neglect emphasizes the primary need of a vigilant and courageous press, especially in great cities. The fact that the liberty of the press may be abused by miscreant purveyors of scandal does not make any the less necessary the immunity of the press from previous restraint in dealing with official misconduct. The dominant purpose of the First Amendment was to prohibit the widespread practice of governmental suppression of embracing information. It is common knowledge that the First Amendment was adopted against the widespread use of the common law of seditious libel to punish the dissemination of material that is embracing to the powers that be. Well said. Secrecy in government is fundamental, anti-democratic, perpetuating bureaucratic errors. Open debate and discussion of public issues are vital to our national health. On public questions, there should be uninhibited, robust, and wide open debate. There you have it, ladies and gentlemen. The courts, the United States Supreme Courts, have set precedence on this matter. Any judge or magistrate kicking anybody out of a courtroom during a public trial for recording, taking notes, acting as individual press, they are violating their oaths and violating the constitutions that govern that state of the union, as well as the Constitution for the United States of America. They are committing treason, and they shall no longer hold office. No more. No more! Tired of this tyranny, we the people will continue to record.
She paints her eyes as black as night now, pulls those shades down tight. Yeah, she gives a smile when the pain comes. Gonna make everything alright. Says she talks to angels. They call her out by her name. Oh yeah, she talks to angels. Says they call her out by her name. A lock of hair in her pocket. wears a cross around her neck.